Maybe some more people are going to join us in the next minutes, at least I hope so, but if not, I'm happy for everyone here who is here to join this panel on the topic forms of fan art, because when thinking of fan art, we usually think of drawing and painting digitally or traditionally, and yes, I'm going to include a bit of that at the beginning too. But the focus of this panel is on the stuff that you may not think of immediately when thinking of fan art, like painting porcelain or engraving glass or burn something into wood or leather or turn pipe cleaners into ponies. Well, before I start with the details, before I start talking too much, I should tell you that talking too much is what I do most of the time. I'm teaching at a Volkshochschule in Bochum and in Dortmund and in Herne. And the thing is, I usually hold presentations of no less than 90 or 180 minutes. So I really had to cut myself short here. As a consequence, there will be some forms of fan art which may have appeared in the program, but which are not going to be part of this presentation. I canceled the clay, I axed the acrylites, and I prepared some other forms of fan art here, which I'm going to show if the time is not running out. However, the final quarter of an hour of this presentation is overlapping with a voice actor panel, so I'm going to try my best to keep it short but informative, then because the main point of this panel is to encourage you to try out some of these forms of fan art, and I'm going to include a lot of tips for people who would like to give it a try, the kind of tips who I would have liked to have when I started it. And of course, questions are always welcome. Keep the microphone close. And so start with what everyone thinks of first when hearing fan art, namely, well, paper as a material, drawing and painting. And I've been holding workshops at Brony meetups for quite a while, and there's one thing I really can't stand hearing, namely, but I can't do that. I don't have any talent. I'm not mocking anyone who says so, for it can be really intimidating, but I'm now going to prove something that many artists claim, but never live up to, namely that their first fan art sucked. So here is my very first piece of My Little Pony fan art, and you cannot recognize it from back there, so here we go. My very first piece of My Little Pony fan art, created in September 2014. Yeah, there's room for improvement. For once, don't draw the ears in the center of the head, and don't make them look creepy, basically. So, my first digital piece of fan art is one where I got very helpful feedback from a good friend for, yeah, it's kind of long, that pony. A bit more like a centipede with two little legs. But when the friend pointed this out, I could, well, it sounds a bit cruel to say that I could cut him short, but that's basically the point. The main point here is when you draw something, also ask people for feedback, including criticism. It may really help to improve it. For once, I was told that the pony was just too long. I couldn't unsee it anymore, which doesn't always keep me from still drawing my ponies too long or the like. For even after years of drawing and creating stuff, you still make mistakes sometimes, but so long you have fun creating it, you should continue and definitely not be scared away from any art you enjoy because you feel that the results are not exactly as you wanted to have them. Okay, but now after the motivational part about starting fan art, I'm going to show a few examples of different means of drawing on paper. Now here we got the outlines only of Her Majesty Queen Chrysalis, but when it comes to actually painting coloring the drawing, there are different means which you can employ. For once, well, not really coloring, but you can create a lot of interesting effects if you just use pencils in different strengths, apply different degree of pressure, or use pencils of different, well, with lead of different degree of hardness to create something like this. Though I must admit that for this drawing, I only used one regular HB pencil, you know, the regular, I think type 2 is the English name for that pencil, the most frequent kind of pencil, and only apply different degrees of pressure. And you can also create some interesting effects if after you painted it completely, you just go along with an eraser along the leg, for example, to create a light effect or something like this. Then there is one medium which, well, I don't really live up to so far, but just an hour ago somebody told me that when it comes to colored pencils, one should really pay very close attention to the quality. Yeah, and I'm using a brand that you will regularly find in the pencil cases made for students who go to school. So yeah, the color, the quality probably sucks. So I should invest into better colored pencils there. But they too can be used in such ways that it looks like basically a photograph. But I'm not the one to use them that way yet. But maybe if I get some more quality. When it comes to felt tip pens, there are some problems there. On the one hand, if you draw with felt tip pens, there is a high chance that as time goes on, the colors may pale out in the sunlight. Then also you can't really apply any degree of, well, any gradient of color, because if you draw with a felt tip pen over another color in felt tip pen, the result is usually a mess. Very often the paper can also get punctured, and you also see the that the lines where they overlap, it shows, it gets a bit darker there, but it's very difficult to use a felt tip pen in order to get the to get effects such as light, except if you leave something completely free. So one medium, and the last one, when it comes to drawing or coloring drawings, that would be the marker pens. They are very expensive. It took a while to get some together, but they allow basically for the kind of effects which you would hope to have with felt tip pens. So you can use them in various shades, by employing a different pen. There's one marker pen which doesn't have any color, but which can be used to suck up color and then apply it again in a different shade. It sounds a bit complex, but it's something relatively easy to learn. But there's a question of the paper. For most papers, don't seem to work properly with markers. One recent recommendation I got is to use just thicker paper to prevent the paper from bleeding. Thicker paper, especially made for marker pens. The thing is, I got two different types of paper, specifically made for marker pens, and it felt like painting on the kind of paper you use to suck up ink blots. The color can easily spread out there. But actually this one, this drawing was done on just a regular kind of printing paper. Anyway, I'm talking too much about just the drawing. So here's another thing you can do with paper, and also one which I'm going to talk about not too much about here. For the last 2 years, I had a presentation about origami ponies. But I'm going to show you first the folding instructions, and you don't need to remember them by heart from the few seconds you see them here right now, for there's a card of my DeviantArt account, and a few weeks ago I uploaded the folding instructions, so anyone who would like to fold a paper pony can check this out at home or later on at the GalaCon. Especially tomorrow, I'm probably going to fold some ponies, and anyone who is interested to learn it can ask me about this. Paper ponies can be folded in quite a few different poses, walking, standing, lying, running, flying, etc. And I also got some paper printed so we can create origami ponies in the appearance of the main six. And yeah, here you see the evolution of the origami pony. I think this was the first Pinkie Pie I tried. And really, don't ever let yourself be discouraged by the first attempts. Okay, move on, Pinkie. Here we have another example. In this case, Octavia along with the cello. And it can also be include some other things. For one basic rule about origami folding is if something exists, then it can be folded out of paper. If something doesn't exist, it can be folded out of paper as well. In most cases, you just need a square piece of paper to fold whatever out of it. And by the way, ponies and the Millennium Falcon are both folded almost identically, just a few final steps are different. Okay. And yeah, even if you don't want to go very complex, this is something that can be learned in a few moments. If you want to fold a paper flower, and if you fold enough of them, you may have a Discordian surprise for Fluttershy, and I wonder what Angel Bunny is thinking about this. Okay, are there any questions? Okay, then let's continue. Stones. Yes, that's forms of fan art which we actually come in, which we can actually see in My Little Pony. Most of us won't be as good as Maud is here, but you don't necessarily need to make statues from stones. For well, one good thing about it is you can find stones everywhere. These are stones which I picked up literally around the corner from my house. So what to do with that gravel? Well, they come in different colors. And if things come in different colors, they can be arranged in ways like this, for example. And really, it's amazing how much the shades of color can vary in regular stones. And without too much effort, and it's a lot of fun, you can create mosaics such as this one or this one. And yes, admittedly, there are some kinds of color difficult to come by in nature. I'm not saying that they can't be found, but if you want to go purple or blue, you may cheat and buy some decorative gravel in order to praise Princess Celestia and maybe involve something that would otherwise end up in the garbage, like some tin foil from, I think it was a Hanuta or something. Anyway. But then those mosaics I showed before were a very passing thing. So I had them lying around for a while, and at some point I had to put it away again. Maybe you want to have something more durable. Anyone who has ever been to Pompeii knows that mosaics can be rather durable too, but that requires a few extra materials, a few extra steps, and some extra tools. Here are some of the materials which you need if you want to create a mosaic for the ages, for later day archaeologists to dig up. Namely, you need, of course, the stones. You can actually buy mosaic stones for the specific purpose. Then you need a kind of net, which is also produced specifically for the purpose of creating mosaics. You then need a special glue, which is used to literally glue the mosaic stones onto a net. And later on, some Fugenmasse, ground mass it is, sorry, I didn't know the English word, but there it is, which you can later on use to fill in the gaps between the stones. So you can end up with a mosaic here. This is a work in progress. Lyra Heartstrings, this, by the way, is about as small as you can go with these stones. It's a much better effect if you plan large on mosaics, but this is roughly about as small as you can go. Here you can see the net on which the stones are glued, and to help you, you can put a print of whatever you want to create as a mosaic behind the net, and then glue the stones on it. Very important. there must be a plastic foil between the ground, the paper, or whatever the net is put on which you put the stones. So the stones won't glue to your desktop, as in, well, the real top of your table. You don't want the stones to be permanently there. I mean, it would be the most awesome desk ever, but it wouldn't be really so usable anymore. Then once you the glue is dry, which is really made to specifically connect stones to the net, you can take the net away, move it around, turn it around without the stones getting loose. I mean, there is some chance that a stone may break loose, but so far it always turned out very solid. And in the end, you can glue the whole thing on any surface, so long you have put some ground, some primer on it. That was the last thing I forgot to mention here. This primer, if you put this on paper, you can glue stones and nets onto it without it ever getting loose again. In case of this mosaic, by the way, I didn't use anything to fill in the gaps between the stones because it was very small already. But you can also turn stones into sculptures. Here, I'll shut up for a moment. A soapstone. No, I can't shut up. A soapstone is a very soft kind of rock. You can actually scratch it with your nails, but you don't need to use your nails only if you want to carve, for example, Twilight Sparkle out of the rock. We see the progress here as it continues. You can use just a file, which you can get everywhere, a file as in, well, similar to what you might use on your nails. Or if you need to work fast, you can also work with a Dremel there. I'm going to show a picture of the Dremel later on. But once the sculpture is finished, you can polish it with very fine-grained sandpaper to make it smooth as soap. That's why the English have the rather proper name soapstone for it. In German, it would be Speckstein. And finally, you can put some oil on it, then the stone will get really, really shiny. And soapstone comes in different colors. It comes in white, it comes in green, it comes in red and brownish tones. Sometimes there are some inclusions in the stone, that is pieces of the stone which are not soapstone and which can give you some trouble if you carve something from it. But it's a very relaxing work to do, but you want to do it outside. For there's one bad thing about soapstone: it creates dusts, lots and lots of very, very smooth dust. And maybe some of you have already heard that it's said that this dust causes cancer or something. It's something that is always told in the internet. The basis for this claim is that soapstone can be sometimes be found near asbestos, which can create cancer. However, all the soapstone sold, at least here in Germany, is definitely checked out to not to contain any asbestos. You don't want to eat the dust, but you don't need to be terrified of it. Unless you do it in your living room, for you will never get rid of the dust. So go outside in summer or have a place that can get dusty if you want to carve soapstone. That sculpture, by the way, is standing there on the table. Everyone is invited to just go and check out some of the forms of fan art, which I set up there. And here I mentioned the Dremel before. This this is not some kind of product placement. It's often referred to as a Dremel. It can be any other company, but it's a handheld drilling machine, basically. It comes with different heads. It can be used on soapstone as well. Though I must say that I got the Dremel for a totally different purpose. Not really that one, but that is another thing that can be done with a Dremel on stone. If you use slate, you know, the kind of stone that comes in layers, it has been used for school boards for a while. If you scratch it, it will get very white. And there are some motifs which you can carve into slate really well using such a Dremel and create things like these plates. Very often plates of slate are sold in stores as a coaster for glasses or something to put under a pot or something. And that's a nice material to work with, really. But that too produces some dust, but not nearly as much as the soapstone will. Yes, not too much to add there, but you can use color on slate as well, if you are sick of paper tearing all the time. Though I must say that slate can also break, so it's not the indestructible image, well, so to speak. Okay, are there any questions? Yes? In this case, it's just acrylic paint, the same I would use on canvas. But in this case, you cannot really create a pre-drawing on slate. I tried it with a pencil, but it doesn't hold very well, or it scratches the stone, so it's tricky to get outlines first before you apply the actual color. Okay, yes, I'll keep this short because you can do this in practice outside. Advertisement, I hope the weather will be as good tomorrow as it has been today in spite of the announcement of meteorological end of the world. So maybe we have a chance to add some more ponies to the crowd outside. The one of the most important things, well, I'm repeating myself here, don't let yourself be scared away because you think you can't do it for. Don't throw hard stuff. This is my first attempt at chalk drawing. And I must point out, this was in 2016, so I had been drawing for a while. I had absolutely no clue what I was doing. And by the way, the derpy up there, that's not my job, that's what somebody else did. But this was my first attempt at, well, Twilight Sparkle. I still think she cursed me ever since, or, well, anyway. The important thing when you draw with chalk is, if you just draw on the ground, you will get a very pixelated image because the chalk rubs off on the uneven parts of the ground. You need to wipe your hand over it to get smoother surfaces, and that way you can also create gradients like shadow and light, etc. And it's a very pleasant material to work with, alas, one that will be gone when the next rainfall comes. But it can also be something to create very special effects. And no, I'm not talking Salvador Dali here. If you look at Trixie being somewhat disfigured here, but if you, I'm not going into the details now how to calculate it, but if you draw a chalk drawing in a distorted way, following certain rules, then you can create an effect which didn't really work out here, for I drew just too small, but from a certain point of view, the proportions look all right. This is the same Trixie as the one with the long head that you saw before, and the real artists who really, really, really know what they are doing can create effects so realistic that people think, oh my God, there is a real pony standing there, or oh my God, I must jump because there is a cliff here, even though there is none. But most of you will have seen one or the other picture of that kind. Oh yes, this was a failed attempt. I'm not going to talk too much about it. Sprayed chalk, I mixed chalk dust with water and sprayed it on stencil, which I created. And unfortunately, the stencil got heated up on the ground and shrunk, respectively expanded. So this was the first result. It could be sort of safe, but I decided not to take any of that along to the GalaCon. Otherwise, my luggage would have exceeded the amount of rarities, I'm afraid. But it is a lot of fun to draw with chalk outside. And very often you get good company there. For the kids from the neighborhood joined the fun. And yes, this is a bonbon which one of the kids there drew, and they drew Trixie several times, so you can get in contact with other people there, and it's also a good activity for brony meetups. If there is any usable ground nearby, for it needs to be on somewhat smooth, but not too smooth. I like the word smooth, but not too smooth ground, basically. Okay. glass. Now we have finally reached the reason why I got that Dremel, which I mentioned before, for it can be used to engrave glass. Some people also have laser machines to engrave glass that makes clearer images, but I don't have one like that, so it's all handwork there. Over there, I really like to use black glass. This isn't black glass, I just filled it with black ink for the lines to stand out a bit better. But whenever you engrave glass, you definitely must wear a breathing mask. And goggles for the dust. I'm talking a lot about dust here today. The dust doesn't cause cancer. However, if you inhale glass dust, it is really not good on basically anything inside you. So wear that mask, wear those goggles, and enjoy when engraving glass. And you can also paint the glass later on. However, if you paint glass, you need a special color. And there are basically two kinds of that, which I'm going to talk again about later. Sorry, there's another image first. If you engrave on black glass, the white lines stand out even clearer than they do on transparent glass. I got one example over there. And if you use different heads for the Dremel, you can create different effects. However, I also found that when engraving a glass, very often it helps to create different patterns, like more strokes along the lighter parts, less of them at the darker parts, rather than trying to create those only with the different heads. There, when you drill on a glass, it will get rough, and if you use a different head with a silicon surface, like an eraser, you don't erase the scratches, but they get less intense. They get smoother, so that way you can darken the glass again, so to speak. And here are some more examples. I don't actually like Baileys. I actually don't really drink a lot of alcohol, but I just love the bottles. If you have any empty black glass bottles here. Okay. And here are some more examples of just engravings. And then the colored version. And finally, I think, yes, here you can see one problem that can occur when you color glass with glass color that is applied with a brush. There are two different kinds of glass colors, namely the one kind that you apply with a brush and the other kind that comes in basically pens. I'm going to show them later on. But one thing that you can see here is that the color tends to get thin along the edges and thicker along the middle. It needn't be a problem, but it can be. It can form an uneven surface. That's something not really that you cannot really prevent when you use glass color with a brush. However, the big advantage of glass color used with a brush is that you can mix it. You can create any color with those. While in case of the glass and porcelain pens, your color range is somewhat limited. So here we have the example glass and color in glasses for the brush and with the pens. Even though it says porcelain pen, the same kind is also sold as glass pane. It's basically the same color. When you color glass or porcelain with those colors, you need to let it dry for some 3 or 4 hours and then put it in the baking oven for half an hour at some 160 degrees, and then it will be firm enough so you can actually put your glass or your cup or whatever in the washing machine. The color won't come off, at least not in the beginning. There can be no holy oath that it will remain just the same for years and years to come if you put it in the dishwasher regularly. Did I say washing machine before? Anyway, sorry. You should never ever put any cup or glass in your washing machine. It's a very bad idea. I know that even though I haven't tried. Okay. But when it comes to these pens, you prefer to use those on porcelain. There are some tips I can give you to create something more than one would expect with a limited range of colors. This is not the completed cup, but when you create such a cup, start with the outlines first. And now we have the problem, okay, with those colors which can be wiped away to get it right just in the beginning, can't there be any outlines applied beforehand? Yes, there can. And this is a technique that can be used for many different forms of fan art. So remember, this is it can be used for pyrography as well. I'm going to talk about it later. You take an image that you want to have on a cup, printed or painted. Then you color the rear side of said image with a very soft pencil, something like 5B or 8B, whatever, a very soft pencil. Then you apply said paper with tape to whatever surface you want to color, and then trace the lines with a harder pencil, and as a result, you will have the outlines on the porcelain or the glass or the wood or the leather or whatever you are working with. Some of you may think of coal paper that can be used for the same purpose. However, I recommend not to use that one, because this method has the advantage that you can always erase those lines, or just wipe them away in case of glass, while in case of copy paper, there may be permanent stains which you don't want to have there. And then, well, you got the outlines, and you can draw whatever character you would like to draw on it. And there is another technique I would like to recommend, namely, when you wait, there should be a bigger image here. When you draw the outlines, just use the tip of the porcelain pen and just dip the outlines with many dots, for this creates a very strong, very intensive color. And then next to it, you can draw with lines, which creates a much softer color. This, the outlines and the side here, this is the same color. But in one case, it has been dipped there, and in the other case, strokes were applied. But you should always let the strokes of the pen end at those lines, for whenever you pick the pen away from the porcelain surface, there will be a little dot. And if that dot is in the outline, it won't be spotted later on. The spot won't be spotted, well, whatever. You can also paint on dark porcelain. It needn't be a white cup all the time, but you can paint on very dark colors too if you apply some grounding, so to speak. Here we have, it's a bit difficult to recognize, but trust me, here is a black cup on a black background. And I painted vinyl scratch onto it. By the way, the parts of her which are supposed to be white were dotted, while the hair, for example, was done with strokes. And this is a basis on which other colors can be applied. So yeah, you get a better idea that this actually is a cup. But you can then, after you let the colors dry and put it in the oven, you can apply the next shade of color onto the white surface there. Okay, it needn't be cups all the time, it can be bowls as well. And now the next form of fan art which I would like to show you, pyrography. Pyrography doesn't mean to blow up anything or something, but indeed it has to do with, well, not really fire, but heat. If you use a hot piece of metal, you can create images on wood or on leather or on cork, for example. And there are some soldering irons created to create just that on wood. Namely, here are two of these. On the one kind, you can get that rather cheap, is this one with sorry, I need to look up the English term there. With a solid paint burner. A solid point burner means that it's basically a soldering iron. You have these different tips up there, the different points I should say, which get heated in this tool, and you can use it to draw, simple as that. In case of the wire nip burner, that's this one, you have a tip more with such curves. But the advantage of that one is that you can vary the color. Here you have the a tool which you can, the part of the tool where you can change the temperature of the wire nip burner to create different degrees of blackness, darkness, whatever. They both have their advantages and disadvantages. The advantage of the this one is that it's a lot cheaper. You can get a really good one for 20 or 30 euro. You can get it even cheaper, but you may not really want to. I used one for 10 euro once, and I used it for 2 minutes, and it was broken. So you better want to go to your Baumarkt and get one for 20 or 30 if you want to try it. And this one is a bit more expensive. I got mine fairly cheap for 40 euro. I think it's like 40 to 80 euro. There can be more expensive ones too, but I've been really working well with this one. However, the first one I got had the coldest temperature of 400 degrees Celsius. That was a bit too hot for me, for it turns the wood black relatively quickly. So I got another one with, and usually I burn wood at a temperature of 250 to 300 or 350 degree. And if it's not dark enough, you can burn the same part of the wood again with the soldering iron. And here are some examples of what you can do. Wood very often comes with, or always comes with its own grain, and sometimes with its fibers, and they sometimes form patterns which you can employ in your images. For example, here you have the lake with Derpy floating above, and I employed the lines, the natural lines of the wood there, so it would not disturb the image. Most of the wood I'm using for pyrography is beech wood, Buche in German, but pretty much any kind can be used, but light kinds of wood, light in the sense of being bright, are the easiest to work with, but yes, you can experiment for yourself if you are interested. Here are some more examples. Yes, one of those school days. And it needn't be just slabs of wood, but you can also get boxes like these to burn, or dices, or leather. For pyrography can be used not just on wood, but also on leather or cork. However, leather and cork burn a lot faster than wood, so you can create almost no shades except by creating different patterns on the leather, and you want to use the lowest temperature you can get when you are working on leather, and you also don't want to use a pointy point on your soldering tool, otherwise it can scratch leather or cork quite a bit. You want to use a somewhat rounded tip. Apart from that, I'm using almost only always the same kind of tip. Here's another example of what can be done on leather. However, the golden part is leather paint, and the green part, the rest, is pyrography. Okay, are there any questions? Okay, I'm somewhat in time, almost, or how many minutes left? Oh, good. Hey, then we can actually include maybe some slides which I didn't use before, or people can get in time to the voice actor panel. But first, there's one more thing I definitely want to show you. If you want to create your own clothes, you can paint on your shirts, you can paint on any kind of textiles with the right colors. And there's a bit of a deja vu here, for the colors to paint clothes come either in big bottles to use them with a brush, or as pens which can be used, well, like pens. And as for this copy paper down there in the image, that one is used to apply the outlines of whatever you want to draw on the closes or whatever you want to draw it on. First thing you need to do is to fix your piece of cloth or whatever on a board. It can be a piece of cardboard, but a piece of plywood works better even. For the textiles must be stretched. You can never have enough of those in order to get the textiles straight. Then you can apply the copy paper on the shirt and place your print or whatever image you want to transfer onto the copy paper and trace the lines. You cannot see them very clearly here, but if you had the piece of cloth in front of you, you could see the outlines here. And those lines will vanish later on when the piece of cloth is washed or it is just painted over. This is a special type of copy paper just for this very purpose. You then proceed to first draw the outlines, paint the outlines, and there are two different ways to do it depending on what color you use. With a brush, with a brush color, it's easier than with the pens. Most people tend to think of the pens as easier because pen is, well, you don't need to dip it into the color all the time. But when you use the pen on cloth, then you will push waves of cloth in front of the pen, unless you use your other hand to always keep the piece of cloth stretched out. That's one important thing. And one drawback of the textile pens is that there's no way to mix colors with those. While in case of the brush colors, you can mix them, and since a brush bends, you don't have to worry about pushing waves of cloth in front of your brush. Yes, and that's what I'm going to wear tomorrow. And here's another example, which I made just shortly before the GalaCon, my OCs on shirts. And if anyone is attending the Brony meetup in Cologne for the rest of the year, there will be a textile cloth coloring workshop. However, before you paint anything on clothes, this is something I should have said first, you need to make sure it's the right clothes. You want something with as much cotton in it as possible. 100% is best. Synthetic color fibers may repel the color. And the second thing you want to do is, before you paint anything on the shirt, it must have been in the washing machine. This time really the washing machine, don't put it in the dishwasher. You want to have it in the washing machine first, because there are what's the English word? I think it was, yes, it was actually dressings on the cloth. The German word is Apparaturen. There are some chemicals on it which make the stuff nice and shiny in the stores, but which repel the color as well. So first wash your clothes before you want to paint them. And then once the colors are applied, you need to iron the shirt, for only when the colors are ironed in, they will stick to the shirt if you put it in the laundry. You will have to check out what color, what temperature is the maximum that the colors can stand in your washing machine. And it is also highly recommendable to turn the shirts around before putting them in the washing machine to keep the colors on for very long. And it can depend very much on the material used, how long they stay in shape. Same as with the cups. If you put them regularly in the dishwasher, respectively the washing machine, chances are it might wear off over time. But even if we don't paint our clothes, they tend to wear off over time. So yeah, okay. Here are some, it's a close shot of the shirt I'm wearing. For one of the most frequent mistakes when you draw clothes is that along the outlines, if you try not to to draw over the outlines, there may be gaps in between the different color layers. But I think the best way to avoid this is to first draw this and then later on draw the outlines a bit thicker onto the textiles to cover up these pieces. However, I cannot talk about cloth painting without making a little shout out to one webpage, stoffe-bemalen.de. Well, it is a German, sorry for the English speakers, but the internet will help you with more advice about clothes painting, but this page stoffe-bemalen.de gives you really all the information you need if you want to create your own, well, My Little Pony clothes. Okay, and yes, the final topic today, if ponies go metal. There is a very deplorable lack of blacksmith shops and furnaces in private households, and it shames me to say that my house is no exception. But I can guarantee you that everyone in this room here is fully capable of creating a metal pony today if you want to. The trick is, what kind of metal do you use? There are different kinds of metal which can be forged without much need of forgery. Wrong term. Anyway, you know what I mean, I hope. On the one hand, there is a very wide range of colored wires, colored wires, you know what I mean, available. And one important advice for beginners, don't get them in your creative artist store, for they are very expensive there. Order them from a florist store online. They will cost about half as much there. And they come in quite a range of colors and can be can be bent by hand. However, what you really want to use is a pony forging pincer. An alternative name is a hemostat, or in German Arterienklemme. That's because they found some alternative uses for this in medicine to keep arterioses, to keep blood vessels closed. Things that are produced for fan art that can be used for different topics. Anyway, those pincers are really helpful, not just to bend the wire, but also if your pony proceeds. You may need to pull a wire without deforming the whole thing. Then you can use these pincers to clip two wires together, and then you can pull on the other end of the wire as much as you want without deforming the entire sculpture in progress. When you create the legs of such a metal pony, you want to use such a vertical frame first, and then use a piece of wood or whatever in the right just wrap the wire around it. If it isn't perfect at the first try, you can still bend and form the wire a bit, not quite like molding clay, but there is a lot that can be fixed later on. And well, very little to say, just continue. This is what it may look like in the end. Oh, and if anyone is interested, at the charity auction, there is a wire canisoda for sale this year. Yes, that was my first wire sculpture. I made one mistake with her, for if you, well, she's running a bit too fast to point out something. You can see it on my webpage if you're interested. When it comes to the manes and tails of the ponies, the best effect is if you use the wire as if they were the hair of the mane and tail. Let them run along the lines that the hair would take. In case of this vinyl scratch, I used it differently, so it looks a bit odd if she was slow enough so that one could actually see it. So later on, I created another vinyl and another Octavia. So there we go. Oh yes, that's the one later on in the charity auction. Hello, image. But if that's a bit too tricky and too expensive, there is the combination of metal and fluff, basically called well, it's called chenille wire or pipe cleaners, Pfeifenreiniger. They are usually very thin wires, so you don't really need this pincer to work with them. You can use some styrofoam bowls to stick the pipe cleaners in them to have a bit of a basic skeleton for a pony like this one. It works a lot faster to create sculptures with chenille wire than with regular wire, simply because the fluff fills in some space. The eyes are the tricky part, but I kept the microphone too far away from my mouth all the time, didn't I? Sorry. But especially if you use the styrofoam bowls, you can pierce them with some wires to create the eyes, such as in case of this Rarity or this Pinkie Pie. Just some more images, you can set them up. And last but not least, tinfoil has a bit of a bad reputation related to headwear lately. However, they put my panel right in front of the voice actor panel to keep me from making this too long, and I should keep this conspiracy theory stuff out. But it's really easy to form tinfoil into something pony shaped, unless you are holding a microphone in your other hand, which I did not take into account. But it's a very cheap material which can be formed very easily in with a lot of detail. There's one artist. Ins? Oh, yes, thank you. Well, high tech, awesome. Thank you very much. No, tinfoil is really something you can find in every kitchen. It's cheap, and you can form ponies or buildings from it. I know one artist in the Brony fandom made all of Canterlot out of aluminum foil, tin foil. And yes, there's a little Celestia and the Tree of Harmony, which I made, which of course I wasn't doing while talking all the time and not looking at what I'm doing, but kind of sort of a very, very, very basic unicornish shape. Okay, anyway.
I owe you a better unicorn for the unicorn later.
Okay, so are there any questions? Okay, then we have reached the end. Here are some credits for some of the images I used, and once again that webpage, which I really recommend to anyone who would like to try out textile painting. Oh, and a final advice I forgot to mention in terms of textile painting, or any time you use liquid colored colors, try to get such capsules from films from the age before digital photography. If you mix any color inside this, it will stay fresh for a very long time. Forgot to mention that earlier. Okay, are there any questions? Then thank you very much, and I'm looking forward to next year.